This podcast is brought to you by Free Buddhist Audio, the Dharma for your life. Our work is funded entirely by donations from our generous listeners. If you would like to help us keep this free, make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. Thank you and happy listening.
So, when I was thinking of the title for this, I came up with two titles, Let Your Inner Riches Shine and Absolute Abundance. So it doesn't matter which one, but they both point at the same thing. And basically, this talk is about one of the Buddhist sort of central values of Buddhism. It's about generosity and how this affects our life's experience. Now, just wait for somebody coming in. In Buddhism, there's lots of lists of different values or teachings, and one of the lists is called the Six Perfections. And actually, the first perfection is generosity. Then there's I don't know quite which order they're in, but there's then wisdom, ethics, patience, meditation, and viri, which is energy. And then we have five precepts, and the first precept is about love and non-harm. Okay, so the negative, that's obviously killing and harm. And then the second precept is generosity. It's actually we say, with open-handed generosity, I purify my body. And the opposite to that, obviously, is stealing. Taking, not given, because it's not as simple as stealing. And then we have what we call three poisons, the three poisons of being human. And the three poisons are greed, hatred, and delusion or unawareness. And the opposites of those, opposite to greed is generosity, and the opposite to hatred is love. And the opposite to unawareness or delusion is sort of clarity, wisdom. So in a way, as a Buddhist, we're sort of trying to move in our lives from one to the other. The idea is obviously generosity, love, and wisdom. And so ideally, we're trying to act in ways that move in that direction. So that's a little bit about, you know, where generosity is placed in Buddhism. It's very highly regarded. I'm going to read a little bit from a book called Buddhism Tools for Living Your Life by another man who's ordained into the same movement I'm ordained into, Vajragupta. And right, let me find where I'm reading. So, one day a beggar comes up to me in the high street and asks me for some money. From over the road, I've seen him approaching me. I've immediately started to feel uncomfortable and started to look the other way. I'm pretending to be fascinated by those ladies' handbags in the shop window. But why is this? Putting aside for a moment all the arguments about whether you should give money to a beggar if he might spend it on drink, why do I feel such a resistance? If I did give him a coin from my pocket, I suspect that when I got my change out an hour later, I wouldn't even notice the missing cash. Why do I feel such a resistance to giving away something I'm not even going to miss? The resistance occurs because we feel that we can't spare anything. We have a sense of inner poverty, inner lack. We think the world owes us, but we cannot give anything. So, this thing about greed, the opposite, sort of comes from an emptiness, so not being in contact with our inner riches, our self-worth, our inner abundance. We think that whatever the thing we desire will fill the inner void, but it doesn't. We just go on to crave for something else. You know, the material world we live in, how it is. We think if we get a new something or other, that actually we'll feel... that'll make it all right, you know. And, funnily enough, you know, not long afterwards we want another something or other, or whatever it is. That's so often the way. And so often we're trying to look for something, whether it's things or relationships or something outside of ourselves to make us feel all right. Whereas actually, we've always been all right, which is what I'm going to try and show you. The second thing I'm just going to read from here, three bits I'm going to read from here. Okay, when we are generous, there is a sense of inner richness and abundance. We're able to relate to the world in a different way, more in terms of what I can give, rather than an attitude of what can I get. We can perhaps reflect on this ourselves. At what times and situations do we find it easy to give? When, on the other hand, do we find it more difficult? It's just that when we do give, generosity fills the sort of emptiness with riches. It sort of fills the riches that shine. Or in fact, it sort of resonates with our inner abundance that is there, has always been there. And actions of generosity reminds us of our worth, of our inner riches. It's normally so often we dwell on our inner poverty. It's sort of like we're our own worst enemy. We're often knocking ourselves, you know, sort of like this chatterbox going on in one's mind. I mean, it might resonate with you or not, you know, but actually it's sort of often running down, oh, I could have done better than that, you know, or you know, sort of, and we don't have to do that because it sort of just gives us a not such a good quality of life. And that this is happening so unconsciously normally and habitually. We have a Buddha figure in Buddhism called Vajrasattva, which is a diamond being. And he's someone who he helps remind us that we've never not been pure, never not been abundant, never not been full of riches. It's not that, in a way, we need anything out there to make us feel all right. We've always been all right. We know when we see acts of kindness out there, or we feel it resonates in our guts. We know when we behave well. We know when we act. It's sort of like it's there. The body knows. We don't have to do anything or change ourselves in any way. It's just getting back. It's getting back to our basic, you know, inner abundance, our inner riches, our purity. And so the riches are always there and have never not been. We just don't choose to notice them and are not aware of them. And they sort of get covered up by all the past conditioning. And our work is to remind ourselves that they are there, returning to the pure state of abundance, of feeling our self-worth and how what a wonder we are as human beings. And living from that, and then we're able to be so open. We don't have to be so fearful and protective because we're feeling good. You know, when you're out there in the world and you're feeling good, you can be open to people, can't you? You can smile. You can, you know, just be there. Other times when you feel a bit down and lacking, you sort of your body posture and you're in and looking at the ground and you think the world's against you, but it's not. It's just your perception. It's what you're doing. It's nothing to do with what's going on around you. So giving, generosity, dana, which is the word in Sanskrit that the Buddha used, dana, actually Danapriya. Okay, so dana, generosity, priya, love. My name, one who loves generosity. So giving, generosity, and dana helps us reconnect with our abundance. So it clears the dust and fog away. Then we shine in all our interactions, creating positivity in the air, and so that we, you know, just we move through our lives just with abundance and joy and happiness, and we don't have to stress ourselves to, you know, trying to find it somewhere else, in somebody else or in something, or I'll be all right then. Well, actually, you're all right now if we just look. Okay. So I'm going to make 12 points now. So I've got 12 short sections that I want to cover. And the first title is called Not About Material Wealth. Okay, so generosity is not about material wealth. I'm going to read the third bit from Buddhism Tools for Living Your Life. Very good book. Anybody wants to know more about Buddhism? You with me? Okay. I realise I'm getting older. My eyes are declining. When I've been in talks before, I've always been able to read through my glasses and look at all you and see you through my glasses. I can't now. Is that under for this? And, or sorry, you know. But my arms aren't long enough for them. Anyway, so where are we? Yes. People are very generous much of the time. In a way, generosity is innate and natural. You may have had an experience which meant a lot to you, and that was really enjoyable. You will often be eager to tell someone about it. You naturally want to share it with your friends. We want to be connected to others, and this can mean we want to give and share with them. We enjoy giving gifts and watching the pleasure of the recipient. There are plenty of other examples of people really giving of themselves to help another. A friend of mine once went travelling in India with his girlfriend when they became very ill. He tried to buy a train ticket to get her to the hospital in the city, but was told no tickets were available for many days. They were both anxious and frightened in a strange country where they didn't know who to trust. The young Muslim man befriended them and offered to help. Could they trust him? They decided to take the risk, and he spent many hours at the train station queuing for tickets and insisting they be allowed to travel soon. He eventually got tickets, but wouldn't accept anything by way of thanks. He just saw two people in need and decided to give his time and help. So, you know, you don't need to be rich to be generous. You can have a generous heart, generous spirit, and a generous mind, yet on a material level have very little. You can be mean-hearted, mean-spirited, mean-minded, yet have, on a material level, absolutely everything. Who is happier? Often the person with more has more to lose, more to hold on to, more stress, more anxiety. It actually does not matter what you have. It's to do with your inner world, your inner sense of self, the degree in which you acknowledge and live from your inner riches. It's an attitude, it's a perception. And it's like, also I'm not saying that you can't have. You can have everything you want. It's to do with your relationship to it. It's not like I'm saying you've got to go and get rid of everything to be happy, because you haven't. It's all to do with, if it went, how would you feel? You know, sort of like feeling real value of just yourself, just because you're you, you know? And that you don't need all these things to shore us up. And the more we connect with those delights that are in us, and we know them because we do experience them, and it's just noticing them more. So often it's our mind will go into the realm of negative thinking rather than positive thinking. So generosity makes us feel abundant of heart, mind and spirit. So the next section is called Give Appropriately. Okay. Now, the Buddha, he talks about this. He said he was able to give with the eye of wisdom and awareness, because in a way, the Buddha is the ideal figure in Buddhism that we, as Buddhists, I look towards. He sort of really worked on himself, and he woke up how things really were. He could see with absolute clarity how things really were in this life. That, you know, if you're greedy, you get one sort of life. If you're generous, you get another sort of life. You know, if you love, you get one sort of life. If you hate, you get another. You know, it's very clear. And just although often in one's daily activity, one knows that on a mental level maybe, but then in our actions in a daily life, it's not so easy to live them out ongoing. But anyway, the Buddha was awake. He had the eye of wisdom. He had great awareness and clarity. So he would be very aware of the people around him, and because he knew himself well, he could be very aware of others around, and therefore, you know, he'd be able to give what was appropriate to them. So anyway, the more and more we to become clearer and wiser, and we know we have clarity on our views and our thinking, the more able we're able to give appropriately to other people. But it's sort of like, don't wait till your motive's superior, just just give, because it just works. We become more aware as we do that, actually. And there's so many things that we can give that have nothing to do with material. So we can listen, we can give listening. You know, we have a friend just listen to us when we really want to be heard. We don't want advice necessarily, just listening. It's a real gift. And energy, we can give our energy. Courage, we can give encouragement. Encourage people, encourage friends, encourage whoever. We can give time, patience, empathy, kindly words. Kindly words go a long way. We often have, you know, kindly thoughts about people, but how are we able to give them to them? It's a gift. It's a gift. And that really nourishes us and them, and that other person's inner riches. They then sort of, hopefully it resonates. If it's true, it'll resonate with them. It'll touch them. And it'll remind them, oh yeah, I do have that. I can do that. Touch. You know, just a touch on the shoulder at the right moment. Actually, it's important, these little things. We practical things we can give. Education. We all have knowledge about different things. We can share it. Our example. Just our example is a gift. If you're, you know, hopefully you're accepting a positive example. Silence. Just sitting silently with somebody can be a gift at certain times. Our company, a smile, a meal, you know, just share a meal. Often we shouldn't be throwing food away these days, should we? So we'll talk. Kindness, interest, it's being interested in another. And then, of course, material things, we can give material things as well. But there's a wealth of things that have nothing to do with that. Okay. So it's like, once in our lives create an atmosphere of just giving, because it creates abundance out there. Also, the more we're able to give, the more we feel abundant. And actually, you just get back tenfold. You know, it's not that you're doing it to get back, but it's fine if you do. Doesn't matter. It's just the way the world works. If I go out there and you know, I give in these different ways, it comes back in loads of other ways. It's simple. Okay, and it's just giving spontaneously. If you're aware and in the moment, you just give spontaneously. So often we miss the moment. And so, as I said before, don't get hung up on your motives. It doesn't matter. You know, okay, I'll give them a nice birthday present and I'll get one back, you know. And that's fine, you know, that's fine. Because good intentions can easily get squashed. We can often think of, oh yeah, we'll give them that, but act quickly, because so often we can talk ourselves out of it. I don't know if you know that, you sort of recognise that in yourself. You sort of think, I'll do that for so-and-so. And then over a bit of time, the energy's gone out of it. Does that resonate with people? So sort of give quickly, or else your good intentions, you squash them yourself, actually. And then, you know, you just in touch more with your lack of self-worth, and you're not feeling very abundant. Giving increases our connection, our interconnection with others, and our inner worth, our inner riches. It just says nothing to do with how wealthy we are on one level. It's how wealthy you are as a human, how you feel in your inner world. Another point I want to make is about feeling the need of another. To be more aware of other people. It's like putting yourself in other shoes. Step out of yourself. So how would I feel in that situation? You know, I think I've heard this, you know, from lots of different religions, lots of different places, but sort of like, you know, just act as you want, you know, to others as you'd like to be acted towards. It's a very simple thing. But do we always do it? Yeah, giving is simply a matter of feeling the needs of another as vividly as one feels one's own needs. Okay, I'm just going to read another little thing. It's by Shantideva, he was an Indian Buddhist monk. He lived between 685 and 763. But what he wrote was amazing and very relevant to us today. Okay, make sure I got the right bit. Yeah. So, first, he will diligently foster the thought that his fellow creatures are the same as himself. All have the same sorrows, the same joys as I. And I must guard them like myself. The body, manifold of its parts, in its divisions of members, must be preserved as a whole. And so likewise, this manifold universe has its sorrows and its joy in common. Although my pain may bring no hurt to other bodies, nevertheless, it is a pain to me, which I cannot bear because of the love of self. And though I cannot in myself feel the pain of another, it is a pain to him, which he cannot bear because of the love of self. I must destroy the pain of another as though it were my own, because it is a pain. I must show kindness to others, for they are creatures as I am myself. Then, as I would guard myself from evil repute, so I will frame a spirit of helpfulness and tenderness towards others. Feel the need of another. Receiving generosity. It's really important, receiving generosity. Because if no one receives, generosity is halted. But so often, you know, particularly, you know, you give a compliment to somebody, oh no, that's not me. You know, or you know, you sort of like try, you know, when you receive somebody saying something kindly to you, how do you feel? Do you say, oh yeah, thank you very much, that's lovely, yes, you're right, you know. watch out next time that happens. It's sort of like we need to receive, trust the person delivering. It's looking at our inner response. You know, obviously if people are just trying to butter us up and say something that's not true, well, you know that, you know. But actually, if somebody, you know, does have the courage to say, actually, you know, I really appreciated when you did that. You know, it made a difference in my life. Thank you. You know, so like, normally it resonates here, nothing to do with what you're thinking. Okay, yeah, thank you. It's really kind. It's like receiving well. Because if we don't receive, it just stops the flow. So we've got to keep the flow of generosity going. And then on a material level, if we are giving gifts we don't need, receive it well, okay? And give it to somebody else who does need it. Okay. I've got a box at home that, you know, I get given things, birthdays, Christmas and other times, and you know, let's face it, these days, I mean, we all have most things to me. And lots of it just goes in the box. And I say, thank you very much. Yeah, it's great. You know, make them feel you know, good about having given me something, because actually they've made the effort, they've thought of me, you know. And so I just put it in the box, and then, you know, birthdays and things and whatever come around, and then I think, oh, if I've got something, oh, I think so-and-so want that. Okay. And I give it, and it's fine, because it's mine to give. It's not bad. You see, you're just keeping it moving, you're just giving more pleasure. I got pleasure getting it, and now somebody else is going to get pleasure from it. You know, so anyway, that's one thing I get up to. We won't talk about the rest. Anyway, receive well, with gratitude, with thanks. Just appreciate the other person's efforts. So, an attitude of generosity. A generous attitude is from a generous mind. A mind that is thoughtful of others and acts. A mind that is able to share. Sharing is a really interesting one. So much we can share. It's a little story that's happened to me. I used to live in a Buddhist community in Bethnal Green, East London, above the London Buddhist Centre. I was there for 9 years, and I lived there with 13, 14 others. It changed as the time went on. And it was one of my days off, and I'd been out shopping. And on the way back, I bought myself a cake. And so that, you know, mid-afternoon, so I got back into the community and got a big sort of kitchen lounge area, and I put the kettle on and put the cake on a plate and thought, yeah, lovely. So I sat down at the counter, just about to start eat my cake, and one of my friends came in, you know, chatting away and there's cakes. and I've got a choice, you know, I can either just get stuck in or I can disappear up to my room. It gives me one experience, okay, well, two actually, you know, but similar experience. Or I said, how would you like half my cake and put, you know, make him a cup of tea? Just two different experiences. And you know, I did share the cake, not too begrudging. but I did recognise my resistance in that as well. But actually, I was so glad I did. Because had I not, you know, I would just load more into my you know, poverty. That I couldn't possibly give half this cake away, you know. I wouldn't be happy, you know, but it's not true. The truth is I was happier actually giving it. Okay, so it's sort of like, if you know, when I'm in a negative mental state, it's harder to give. Anyway, if I'm in a negative mental state, say ill will towards someone, if I reach out and give something to them, kind communication, cup of tea, positive thought. We have I teach two meditation practices, and one's called the Metta-Bhavana, which is called the cultivation of loving kindness. And the fourth stage in we put in somebody we're having difficulty with at the moment. And it's very good to sort of try and see a broader perspective of this person, that they're not just doing something I don't like. That's them, you know. But actually getting a broader picture that they too are loved by people, and so just opening it up. And actually I upset people at times. You know, I don't not mean to, but it's sort of like we just all get in that fourth stage at times. So it's sort of like there is somebody I'm finding difficult with, it's sort of like try and find something to give, even if it's just a positive thought to them. Because what happens is, who's holding on to the negativity and negative thoughts? Who's suffering? Who's getting stressed shoulders and headaches and dis-ease? It's you are, you know, I am. It's the one holding on to the negativity, holding on to the irritation, holding on to the anger. They could be fine off doing whatever they're doing. You know, and if they are suffering, well, they're doing that to them. It's not their fault that I'm suffering. I'm doing it. I'm choosing to go down that spiral of negativity and tightness and a sort of inner poverty, really, actually. Whereas I could just sort of really connect that. Actually, no, I'm bigger than that. I could be kind to this person. You know, they must be having a hard time or something, you know. It's just like bringing the positivity out. And you will feel better. It doesn't matter what the other person's getting up to. But normally what happens is if you change it within yourself, it changes with the other. Your connection with the other changes. So it's all ways of giving, which actually often hardest bit area, but actually when we do it, it really brings riches. It really sees that, oh yeah, I was able to change that situation. I was able to give to myself, actually, that kindness. And I was able to give to the other, to actually forgive. You know, it's just a moment in time. Things move on. Yet, my God, we can hold grudges for years, can't we? Anyway, this creates a radical change in my mind. I stop suffering so much. And the atmosphere changes from one of pain and negativity to one more of peace, calm and positivity. Okay. It's about how do you want your inner landscape to be. Be humble at times. All still awake? It's quite warm, isn't it? We struggle between having the windows open or not, because the noise, traffic's so noisy, but chef, you're about to pass out, we'll open the window. Okay, next one. Awareness stroke mindfulness is essential. Awareness stroke mindfulness is essential. We have the second meditation practice that I teach is about creating more awareness, more mindfulness in our life, becoming more awake to how things are. And awareness is essential to be able to be able to give well. If you're not in your life, not in the moment, you miss the many opportunities to give. And actually, generosity, dana, it's a natural, spontaneous and creative state, but we need to be there, or to miss it, you know. So like, the moments happen, you know, instead of getting irritated about the person who sort of just darted out in front of you, you know, when you're driving along, you could have just sat there and allowed them to go. It's just a flip of the mind, yeah? They got in my way. Well, actually, you know, you could just decide to sit there and I'm going to let them go. and sort of being in the inner abundance and the moment and the awareness, and then you don't have to sort of seethe down the road, you know, actually holding steam will be quite hard. Anyway, this all resonates with some of you. Or it's maybe just me. Okay, where am I? What am I doing? Okay, yeah, so, you know, dana, generosity, is natural, spontaneous and creative. It can only be this if you're there. And what happens in my experience, okay, is we miss the opportunity through unawareness. So, like, later we think we could have acted generously in that moment, but it's too late, you've missed the moment. Could have opened the door for that person rather than sort of barge through and nearly knock them over. And I was going to have this later, but actually it's just come to my mind now. I was thinking about this morning, how time's a really interesting thing. I'd give a whole talk or three on time, but why are we in such a rush? You know, why is this hand on our back, you know, sort of like almost, it's like there isn't a moment just to, you know, open that door for the person or let someone go. Or it can appear like that a lot of the time. I mean, it might not be like this in your life, but so often it appears that people got this hand on their back, putting a tie, you know, sort of like as if there's a rush on. You know, our life's going to be as long as it is, or we can live it stressed with a hand on our back, or we can, you know, live it more spaciously, a bit more slowly, but be present, be in it. Feel the riches, not miss them. Another thing is, it's sort of like this thing about giving quickly, or else, as I was saying earlier, all the reasons come in as to why not to give. You know, awareness is essential to be able to give. It's about our mind, how our clarity of our mind, our thinking in the moment. So often we're not in the moment, we're on to the next thing, we're in the future, we're in the past, and actually we miss our whole experience. We miss our life. I mean, I've said this a few times in a few talks, but I'll say it again because it's so important. I mean, I realised probably in the 30s I'd missed most of my life to that point. I'd missed it. You know, whether I was either looking forward to a holiday, you know, So it's over there. And then, you know, when I'm on holiday, I'm looking forward to going home, and I'm thinking about the next holiday because this one isn't quite meeting my expectations. Or, you know, I'm looking forward to retirement, you know, or whatever it is. You know, it's sort of looking forward or looking back and just missing the moment. And I'm sure, I know you've all had moments where you've been totally present, totally absorbed. It's normally in nature, watching sunset, sunrise, small child, totally absorbed. Just really content and at peace. It's wonderful. You know, anybody not have that? Yeah, but in a way, what I'm just encouraging is, well, we can have that more ongoing. just to have that calm without the hand on our back, pushing us through time, missing it all. Okay, so, yeah, awareness is essential to be able to give. Try this out. And see how it feels. Now the next bit, I've called it Danapriya verses 1 and 2. Danapriya's, quite a few who know, is like a Buddhist, it's got all the Buddhist teaching in. I was going to say Bible, but it's not the Bible, you know, it's got pithy teachings in it, you know. Actually, all you need was this. Have you read nothing else? And really saw what this was saying. It's all you need if you want to be Buddhist. Okay, so let me read instead of rattling on. All right. So experiences are preceded by mind, led by mind, and produced by mind. If one speaks or acts with an impure mind, suffering follows, even as the cartwheel follows the hoof of the ox drawing the cart. Experiences are preceded by mind, led by mind, and produced by mind. If one speaks or acts with a pure mind, happiness follows like a shadow that never departs. So what we turn our mind to makes the difference. Our views, our emotions, our drives, our actions, they all come from our mind, our own mind. It makes the difference to our lives and those around us. So I sort of encourage you to know your mind. Do you know your mind? So often we are behaving habitually, and we wonder why we make the same mistake again and again. And so, well, just because we haven't looked at our mind, we don't know our mind. And the more we know our mind, the more we can act with a pure mind, and the consequences that come from that will be different than an impure mind. So mind is so important to know our own minds. So we need to look at ourselves, our minds, know ourselves, change ourselves in accordance with what we know, you know, what we find out, and with our values, your own values. We're sometimes so blind to ourselves. And that's why Buddhists meditate. We meditate to know ourselves, to see more clearly who I am, what's going on. And I'm all colours. There's a lot of negativity, there's a lot of positivity, but until I know what is going on there, I don't know how to change or where to move. But the more I just sit and look, I know. I'm in a driving seat, and, you know, I'm in a positive position to move. How do I want to be in this life? You know, I mean, I want to sort of have a positive influence in this life. You know, I sort of like, but I've got to know, make sure I'm able to do that myself, to be that to myself, before I can do that with anybody else. So it's sort of like we are blind to ourselves, but so meditation definitely helps that. That's definitely one tool that's helped me enormously. It's sort of to look at my mind and at my heart. It's not selfish, and it's not self-centred to look at yourself. If we know ourselves, accept ourselves in all our colours. Okay, we can give from our in abundance, rather than believing that we are poverty-stricken. Because actually you see how rich you are. And actually, when we come from, you know, we say this, the poverty-stricken mentality, we feel we've got nothing to give, we feel we've got no worth. So many of our problems comes from our sense that we sort of feel we're not worthy in a certain way. We may not think that on a day-to-day level, but when one starts to look at it, so often that's what gives us most problems. But the sooner we see that that's not the truth, that it's something below that, that, you know, just because, you know, the teacher told you at school you couldn't sing, well, you go to life, I can't sing. Well, everybody can sing if you go to the right teacher, you know, that's all right. It's just the mind, you need to change the belief. It's very strong, the mind. And if we don't know it, it'll can lead us into some funny places. But if we know it, take the driving seat, can lead us into some abundance and wonderful places. Okay. Yeah, and sadly, so often you can witness that the material world we currently live in leads to separation and isolation. So many more people are living on their own, you know, able to, you know, not need support of others in a sense, which is a shame because it stops sharing stops and lots of sort of generosity isn't necessarily as needed like it is when things are a little harder times are about. You know, often when there's tragedies or difficulties, you see so much more just spontaneous giving actually, and it's such a shame we wait till that moment because it's always there to give. But we need to take care of ourselves, know oneself. And if we do that, we're able to take care of others and know others too. So being in connection with people, with our values, with a generous heart and mind, okay, enhances lives, not just yours. So a happy, healthy human being, this is a major part of this, is feeling connected to others, feeling connected to ourselves. Generosity connects. Okay, I really like this one. It's called Little Things Go a Long Way. Little Things Go a Long Way. It's another little verse I've got here by Shantideva, the Buddhist monk from all those years ago. It says, one's own nature mastered, one should always have a smiling face. One should give up frowning and grimacing, be the first to speak, a friend to the universe. I really love that little verse. It says so much, actually. One's own nature mastered. So that's what I was talking about before. Knowing oneself. Okay. One should always have a smiling face. You know, if you're feeling rich within, you know what it's like walking down the street and somebody smiles and you don't know them. It does lighten your day, doesn't it? You know, and if I'm able to do that to somebody else, it's a gift. And actually, it brightens up mine, and it's sort of like it just makes a connection. It can be so small, but a smile, you know, is so simple, free, but it just depends what you're doing with your mind and how you're feeling about yourself, whether you're able to just change the shape of your face. You know? But I love that. It's because I think it has so much effect. And one should give up frowning and grimacing. Well, yeah, we frown and grimace when we're feeling in ourselves, aren't we? We're choosing to hold on to suffering often, but we can't see we're doing it because we create all our own suffering. Nobody else does it to us. Okay, and a friend to the universe. Really? Why not? It'd be lovely, wouldn't it? Everyone's just able to see with their mind that they could be a friend with every human being, you know. It's totally possible. And be the first to speak. You know, so often we're afraid to be the first to speak to these other humans. You know, good morning. You know, it's lovely, isn't it? Again, often it's a stranger and you get, good morning, you know. Or you see somebody you sort of, you know, as acquaintance and sort of, you know, they walk by and say, well, they didn't speak to me. But actually you can just say hello, you know, because something, you know, we all know what that's about. You know, one's just a bit frightened they won't speak to me or something, you know, that's something quite a lot goes on in that moment. But you can just give, and if they don't respond, well, that's fine. You don't say, well, they didn't speak to me. You know what I mean? It's like just be able to feel rich enough to give whether you get back or not. Anyway, little things go a long way. A smile. The first to speak. A hand on someone's shoulder. We don't, you know, when, you know, somebody just touches you like that in the right moment, you know, when you've had that done, you feel it, it feels really nice, isn't it? It's so little. And you don't know the one giving it, how nice it feels. Does that resonate? Can you do that? And opening the door. You know, somebody, a thought, a flower. You know, just picking a garden, a flower out of your garden, just giving it something. It's so little, but actually it's it lightens and gives abundance to people's hearts and lives. It's so little. A kindly word, a compliment. We notice a lot of things about people, you know, and those good things that people love me just to give them, feel. It sort of perfumes your world. A warm welcome. You know, when somebody, you know, arrives at your house or when you see them, just a warm welcome, you know, it's lovely, isn't it? You know, if you're welcome, you know, so often we feel we're not going to be wanted, or, you know, you pop round spontaneously at somebody, you know, what do you want at a meeting, you know? but hey, we're all learning. Okay, and so give something little every day. Give something little every day. Little things go a long way. Next section, giving is enjoyable. I'm not trying to encourage anything that's actually unpleasant. You know, it's really enjoyable. It's expansive, it's connecting. Creates friendship, creates good feeling, creates positive emotion. So it works against the well of negativity that sadly as us humans have, we have to work against. Receiving is pleasurable. Seeing someone give is pleasurable. You know, when you see people giving to others in lots of ways, it's sort of just, it's nice, isn't it? You know, if you really see it and feel it, it's lovely. Seeing someone receive is pleasurable. It creates a magic field of delight and positivity wherever generosity arises. It also generates more giving. You become an example. Giving is enjoyable. Seeing someone being selfish is distasteful. Seeing someone being mean is grating. Seeing someone being greedy is unpleasant. But seeing displays of generosity in many forms perfumes the air, warms hearts, and inspires. Your example shines and makes a difference. Three more. Okay. Generosity builds friendship. We can give friendship. Friendship is a wonderful realm. It's a wonderful realm. In friendship, there's so many opportunities to give and be given too. It's a great value. You know, so many things again. You know, some of these I've said before, but giving, listening. Availability, understanding. You know, your friend often, you know, they understand you because they know you, support you, encourage you. You know, sort of be interested, patient, help when they're unwell, help when they're unwell. They don't always have to be well, you know, to be a friend. Help their friends and family too. And also, well, at some point, you know, one of your friends will die or have died. We can still give them, you can give to their family, you know, you can just give in other ways, through thoughts. You can share with your friends, you can lend, you can rejoice in them. You can really, just, why are they your friend? You can speak well of them in their absence. I think we all know if somebody's talking to you and they're running a friend down, it's actually rather unpleasant, isn't it? So, you know, speak well of your friend in their absence. Yeah. And also give honest feedback to your friend with kindness. You know, things that, you know, actually it'd be good that they would be pleased to be mirrored back, that something that actually they're doing that actually isn't helping them in their life, you know? And often these are the delicate areas that we see in our friends, actually, but we're often so frightened of giving that gift of mirroring. And actually, if we just find the right words, the right moment, it's such a gift. I know I've been told many times by many friends over the time, I mean, if you live in a Buddhist community with 13, 14 others for 9 years, you certainly get shown yourself, which is great. But actually, you know, I also have it with, you know, my friends in everyday life. And they've told me some things that, you know, so I really like that, or did I really say it like that, you know? And it's like, but thank you. Thank you for seeing, because we seldom, we don't see ourselves that clearly. We need people to mirror us back. And it, and what happens is, if a friend has the courage to sort of say, actually, Danapriya, you know, when you did that, actually, it wasn't very, it felt really unkind, you know. It's sort of like, I know they love me. I know they want the best for me. Because they had the courage to point it out to me. Because if what they tell me is true, I feel it. I know it. You know? But if they're just trying to be unkind and it's not true, well, I know that too. We know if we trust ourselves. Okay, so I think that part of friendship is really valuable. But it needs to be given well and with kindness in the right moment. We can also give practical help to our friends. We can do things the way they like them, not the way we think that they ought to have them done. But sort of like, with awareness, we can see, well, what would my friend like? Not what, you know, I want to change them, it would be like that. Oh dear, right, what am I up to? Yeah, give space, ring them, send them cards, write, and these days email and text when you're not around. You know. Keep them in mind. Keep giving, even during disagreement. We fall out with our friends here and there, small things, bigger things. So just through difficult times, whatever their response, keep giving in some way. The Buddha says, however you are spoken to, train yourself in loving kindness. So like, being unkind back gets you unkindness back. You know, if only we'd learned this in this world by now. You know, we wouldn't keep fighting everybody and killing each other, you know, all over the place. But if only we'd learned that, I think the most courageous thing to do, the most human thing to do, is just keep being kind, keep giving kindness. Okay? So don't be touchy. It's not pleasant. It's like, again, keep giving to your friend, even during disagreement. Okay, so generosity builds friendship. Give to the wider society. Give to the wider society. By your example, be an exemplar. Give ideas. Share your knowledge. And you can give money if you've got it. You can raise it. There is always a positive project in need. Generosity helps build connection and community, and dispels loneliness and disconnection. Give of yourself. Okay. It's warm up here, so it's probably warm down there. So the last point. Gratitude. How much do we take for granted? Okay. So feel grateful of all that has been given to you all through your life. We've been given so much in so many ways. And it's really heartening and nourishes our inner worth if we just notice what we've been given and what we're given to continually. This all connects us to our abundance, to our inner riches. We lead such rich lives in this country. Many of you have heard me say this before. But we do lead such rich lives in this country. And it's only because I would suggest hundreds of thousands, millions of other people we don't know, we've never met, are doing things to enable us to live the lives we need. You know, what did I have for dinner tonight? So I had rice, which was grown somewhere, Italy, I think, Italy. So it's grown, tendered, I don't know what you do with rice, pick it or something, anyway, dry it, I don't know. But you do lots of things with it, and you bag it, and I imagine it was flown over, and so that aircraft was built by people, designed, there was fuel, you know, you just go on and on and on, just with my rice. Let alone I had red split lentils and bouillon and what I have, green beans. Well, actually, those were grown in my neighbour's allotment, so they didn't have, they're not too much of them. But I'm grateful to Clive and Mo for growing them. but, you know, and just, to, you know, standing in my shirt, you know, it's cotton grown somewhere. And with everything you look at, you can just see numerous people enabled. Well, first of all, the choice, you know, there was dozens for me to choose from, you know. And it just goes on and on. So it's like connecting with the gratitude that, you know, people built this hotel and made the chairs sitting on now, and it goes on and on and on, emoji glasses or whatever. It's sort of like really connecting how we're able to live such rich lives. And it's because there's millions of people we don't know, but thank you. Thank you for doing it. And of course, some we do know. You know, just living in whatever town you live in. There's a lot of people doing things there which help your life. You know, either serving your tills or, you know, driving the train or whatever. We don't know them, but thank you. It's like just connecting. It just connects you and it feels there's an abundance out there. And what you're doing has effects in whatever way. However, whatever one's doing in one's life has an effect. And what sort of effect do you want to have? Okay, so gratitude is a natural human response. Nothing we have to sort of look very hard for. Connect with this feeling. It enables you to feel abundant. You then feel you have something to give. You feel connected to others rather than separate. Connected to your inner riches, your absolute abundance. That is always there and always has been. You're not looking for something that's not there. Let your inner riches shine.
We hope you enjoyed this week's podcast. Please help us keep this free. Make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. And thank you.